with the hydrogenation of fats. Okay, hydrogenation of the fat. Hydrogenation means you are adding hydrogen. Hydrogen. So we know that hydrogenation means addition of hydrogen to double bond. Okay, hydrogen to double bond. We know that fatty acid has carbon-carbon double bond. Carbon-carbon double bond. When it is added with when you add hydrogen in presence of a catalyst, you need a catalyst here. Okay. Usually there are a number of other catalysts that are being used, but the most common one is used is nickel, but there are palladium and there are other also, but I know palladium is also one catalyst, but most commonly used is this nickel. So in presence of this nickel, and when you add the hydrogen, what is going to happen when you add the hydrogen? This double bond gets converted into single bond. What do you mean by the double bond? Double bond means a polyunsaturated. A polyunsaturated fatty acid gets converted into no double bond. No double bond means single carbon carbon single bond means a polyunsaturated fatty acid is getting converted into a saturated fatty acid. Okay, double bonds are converted into single. That means the liquid oil is converted into a solid form. Okay, a solid form. This process is a very, very important in the fats and oil industry. Why? Because you know that the moment you have in the oil or in the fat more double bond, it is going to decrease its shelf stability. So to improve the shelf life, the carbon-carbon double bonds are converted into carbon-carbon single bond by addition of hydrogen to an unsaturated fatty acid. So hydrogenation is a process in which a hydrogen is added to convert an unsaturated fatty acid into a saturated fatty acid. Is called as a hydrogenation, and there are two major objectives that are achieved through this process. The first is it converts a liquid. Carbon-carbon double bond means the oil is liquid. It is a liquid. More the number of carbon bond, more it is liquid. The moment you have converted this double bond into single bond, we have seen saturated and unsaturated fatty acid. So saturated fatty acid has no double bond. So we are converting a liquid oil into a solid oil or a solid fat. A liquid oil is converted into a solid fat. So that, or you can also convert it into a semi-solid or a plastic fat, or as per your own consistency one can go. Okay, so we will see slowly, such as you can convert them into shortening, or you can even convert them into a very, 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 very hard margarine. Or you have seen, you know, a frozen butter. If you keep a butter in the fridge, how it becomes? It becomes like a stone. Very, very hard. So what do? You convert a liquid oil into a solid fat. And this will result into either a semi-solid. It depends. Like, it's the process, you know, it's the process. And it depends on, you know, the hydrogen. So, and the second important objective that achieves is oxidative stability. We have seen, let me stop here and then Let me share with you. So, all of us have seen that, all have seen that so in the process of so it's the process of hydrogenation addition. Okay, so what you are doing, you are converting this carbon-carbon double bond in presence of a catalyst nickel. When you add hydrogen and converting this carbon-carbon double bond into carbon-carbon single bond, so you are trying to convert an unsaturated fatty acid into a saturated fatty acid, and you are converting a solid a liquid fat into a solid fat. So we know that, suppose, you know, suppose you have a fat, okay, a fat, okay. So the fat which has a double bond, we all know that the liquid nature of the fat is because of the presence of double bond, So in the process of hydrogenation, you add hydrogen here so that this double bond is converted into single bond. And the moment you have this single bond, the liquid oil is getting converted into a solid fat. Okay, so let's take an example and see how one can, or how industrially it is converted. So basically, more carbon to carbon double bond in a fatty acid. See, there are number of factors that will affect on the hydrogenation process. So a hydrogenation process is the process. Let me share my slide. So you all know that, you know, in the hydrogenation process, you see on the slide, this is your a butter or a ghee. This is a ghee. This is a butter, or you can also call it as a margarine. Okay. And when you look at this oil, which is liquid, maybe it is either a sunflower oil or any oil. So basically, when you look at the fats generally are called as a solid, whereas oil are liquid at room temperature. So when you look at the stearic acid, which has no double bond, which is therefore a fat which is solid, okay. Whereas if you have this unsaturated fatty acid and oleic acid, 18 carbon atom and one double bond. Then you have a linoleic, 18 carbon atom with the two double bond. See, there is one double bond, two double bond. Here one double bond, two double bond. And this is linolenic acid, 18 carbon atom. There are three double bonds. And we know that these double bonds definitely affect on the melting point. Okay, so melting point of fat is affected because of the presence of the double bond. Do you know why this melting point affects on the double bond affects on the melting point? On second or third lecture I mentioned, because of the presence of the double bond, The molecules are going away from each other. The molecules are away from each other, and also, you know, is because of the forces between them. The forces between them. Okay, the forces between. And generally, you must have heard about intermolecular forces and intramolecular forces. Okay, naturally there are two types of forces present in the molecule: intermolecular forces and intramolecular forces. Intermolecular forces means between the molecules. See, this molecule will react, this molecule. So between this molecule and this molecule also, between these two molecules, there will be some forces of attraction. Okay, forces of attraction. You must have heard or studied London dispersion forces during your 12th standard, I'm sure. So these, because these London dispersion forces are present in everything, every molecule, everything that you see in and around. So what happens in these London dispersion forces? So basically, you have a molecule. So there is a force between the molecule, and also there is an intramolecular force. Within the molecule, there is a force. See, for example, today you students are attending my class. Okay. So there are many students, almost more than 10 students attending my class today. But then there is a force, you know, here you people are attending. So whether that force of attendance or why you are here attending is because of the intermolecular force or intramolecular force. Obviously, there is a strong willpower or strong determination between all of you, each one of you, and that is why you are attending the class. It is not because, you know, somebody else from your class is attending class, and that is why you are. Of course, there is a that reason also, that there are 9 people are attending class, and why should I stay at home, or I should not attend? 9 are very vigilant and actively participating, and therefore I should also participate. Of course, there is an intermolecular force also, but then more than that, you yourself decided that yes, I should attend the class, and that is why you are attending. So intramolecular force is obviously stronger, and similarly for any molecule, there is a intramolecular force as well as the intermolecular force. So because of this London dispersion force, the forces are between the molecule attract themselves. So the moment you have, and these London dispersion forces, you know, are affected because of the, like the attraction between, suppose there is one fat molecule or one fatty acid. The force of attraction between these two molecules is affected due to the London dispersion forces. Okay, and the London dispersion forces are affected because of many reasons, like the surface area or the contact area between the two molecules. Suppose this molecule is here and this molecule is here. One molecule is very far and the other molecule is very far. So obviously the London dispersion forces will be poor if the molecule is farther. Okay. So because of this double bond, the molecules are farther, and that is why the forces between two of them are less. Whereas if you look at these, you know, if you look at these, they're very compact, very, very closely, and because they are very near to each other, because they are very close to each other, the London dispersion forces are obviously higher. London dispersion forces are also affected because of the melting point, and obviously if you have a very firm product or firm fatty acid or the molecule which are very compactly packed, and then therefore they will have a very high London dispersion force, and they will have a very good intermolecular forces, and then and because of that, it will be very difficult for all of us to, you know, separate this each molecule, and that is why the melting point will go higher. Obviously, the melting point of butter is higher than the melting point of this oil, which is, you know, liquid. The melting point in the butter also, you know, if you have a margarine, the melting point of the margarine is going to be much, much higher than ghee. Ghee will have a lower melting point. So there are, you know, factors which affects on the melting point, we will see in the next slide, okay? So basically, the melting point of the fat on oil. Why I am discussing the melting point? Because in the hydrogenation process, one has to play with the melting point of the fat. So one desire for semi-plastic fat or plastic fat or a very hardened fat or a very hardened fat, okay? For example, margarine, or you get the hydrogenated fat. So each one of them have a different melting point, and we play during hydrogenation with the melting point, and that is why I am trying to explain the melting point, okay? So the melting point of a fat and oil depends on two factors. One is the molar mass of the molecule. Like, greater the molar mass results into the stronger London dispersion forces. I explained, you know, in the London dispersion forces, suppose you have a molecule, so a molecule will have protons and then electrons. So electron and proton, okay, two protons and two electrons. If you take an example of helium, I think I have that slide in the next, okay. So between the molecule, and there will be a higher melting point. Greater molar mass results into a stronger London dispersion forces between the molecules and higher melting point. Also, in case of fats, you know, that is applicable. We will see, like, if you have more number of carbon atoms, the melting point will be higher. Suppose you have a 16 carbon chain, like 16-0, the melting point of this molecule will be lower than a 18.0. So number of carbon atoms, the chain is longer, the chain higher will be the melting point, okay? Also, the surface area between the molecules, like saturated fatty acid molecule, have a greater surface area between the chain, which is resulting into a stronger London dispersion forces, okay? So a melting point of a solid is the temperature at which it changes from a solid to liquid phase. Solid to a liquid phase. The melting point is usually an index of force of attraction between the molecule. I give you an example. For example, if you have a stearic acid, okay, stearic acid. It's like just a, you know, stearic acid. This is your stearic acid. A straight chain, no double bond, no molecules are separated. So this molecule is very, very compact, very compact. So obviously, stearic acid is going to have a higher melting point than a linoleic or linolenic acid or an oleic acid, okay? So during hydrogenation, what you are doing, you are taking an unsaturated fatty acid with a double bond and adding the hydrogen here and converting that unsaturated fatty acid into a saturated fatty acid, okay? The greater the attractive forces between the molecule, the more easily they will associate to form the solid, obviously. A lot of energy in the form of heat is required to convert the solid. And that is why, you know, stearic acid has a higher melting point than the linoleic acid. Or if you take an example of, you know, margarine. So we are converting. And then when you want to convert a liquid oil into a solid fat, a lot of things are decided based on the melting point. Whether you want a plastic fat, whether you want a semi-solid fat, whether you want have a hardened fat is all based on the conversion of this. Okay, so if you look at this, what is happening? This reaction, hydrogen can be added. So in the earlier, just I mentioned, you know, so you have a double bond, okay, carbon carbon double bond, okay, this carbon carbon double bond is here. So what you are doing, you are breaking here by adding the hydrogen atom here and converting. It's a very simple, okay, very simple phenomenon, converting this double bond into single by adding this two hydrogen atom here. Now you will ask a question here to me. Just a minute. Okay, so in the hydrogenation process, hydrogen is added across the carbon-carbon double bond in an unsaturated fatty acid, and this reaction is called as a hydrogenation, and it decreases the level of unsaturated. You are converting this double bond into single, and that means you are converting the unsaturation. The reaction takes place at a high pressure, and a temperature. Okay, depending upon, there are multiple number of factors that affect on this process, but then it is conducted or it is taken place at a high pressure and in presence of the catalyst nickel. Because this process is conducted at very, very high temperature and high pressure, you know, usually in the industry, you are not allowed to enter the place where hydrogenation takes place, because there are chances that there are a lot of hazards, safety rules and hazards being followed. So the reaction takes place at a very high pressure in the presence of a nickel catalyst, but there are others also which could be used, like as I mentioned before, palladium, but then platinum or palladium are a little, you know, expensive, and that is why, you know, nickel is usually used. And the resultant product of the reaction you see is saturated fatty acid and unsaturated, or maybe, you know, this is one double bond, but, or this is a monounsaturated fatty acid, a MUFA. But what if you have a poly? P-O-L-Y, poly means many, many double bonds. A polyunsaturated fatty acid could also be converted into a saturated fatty acid, and the resultant product is a solid mass. So this advantage of this reaction is you get an increased melting point. Also, decrease in the rate of oxidation. Now look at this. Is this molecule highly unstable or prone to oxidation, or this molecule? Obviously, this molecule is very, very stable against the oxidation compared to the this molecule. This molecule is highly unstable. Therefore, the advantage is it causes increase in the melting point, it decreases the rate of oxidation, and therefore increase in the shelf life, increase in the shelf stability. Also, there is a fourth advantage of hydrogenation is, you know, carrying a block of fat is easier than the carrying a liquid oil of, you know, during transportation, it becomes very easy to carry a solid fat, because then it will not spill off, and also obviously it will have a longer shelf life, so transporting from one place to another. Okay, so there is also, you know, here, now you will ask me a question. Let me stop this. So suppose you have an oleic acid, okay, oleic acid, which has only one double bond, okay, one double bond. So one carbon-carbon double bond, and I am performing hydrogenation on this process, okay. So if you have one carbon-carbon double bond, you will need one hydrogen, okay, one hydrogen molecule, two hydrogen molecule, one will attach here, one will attach here. Two hydrogen molecules. If you have two double bond, you are going to need, you know, two. So to break one double bond, you need one H2 molecule. Two double bond, you need two H2 molecule. So the more the number of double bond, more is going you are going to need hydrogen molecule. Okay. So now you will ask carbon carbon one double bond in presence of one H2 molecule gets converted into a saturated fatty acid carbon carbon. But what if you have a saturated fatty acid and a reaction with the hydrogen in presence of nickel carried out at 200 degrees Celsius, a hydrogenation is carried out. What is the result? Can anyone tell me? A saturated fat is further added with the hydrogen and, you know, performed with the hydrogenation reaction. What will happen? No one? Hello? So?
Yeah, ma'am.
Are there any student attending the class or there is no one in my class?
No, we are here, ma'am.
We are here.
Hello, hello. Yes. Are there anyone?
Yes.
Well, can anyone say hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
We are there, ma'am.
So, a carbon-carbon with a no double bond, a saturated fatty acid when added with the hydrogen at 200 degrees Celsius and under the nickel catalyst, a hydrogenation performed, there will be no reaction. No reaction. Please take it in mind, fatty acid having only carbon-carbon double bond or a point of unsaturation only take part in the reaction called as a hydrogenation. A saturated fatty acid with no carbon-carbon double bond will not participate in the hydrogenation reaction, only carbon-carbon double bond. So it doesn't matter if it is even one double bond, the fatty acid will take part in the hydrogenation process. Without this double bond, nothing will happen to a saturated fatty acid under hydrogenation reaction. No reaction will take place. It will remain as it is. Okay? Remain as it is. So hydrogenation, we understood that carbon-carbon double bond when added with the hydrogen, it is getting converted into single bond. Okay? You get this CH. So an alkene, you know, this is an alkene. Alkene is converted into alkane. But in case of fatty acid, we don't use the word terminology alkene or alkane. We say unsaturated fatty acid is converted into saturated fatty acid. And unsaturated fatty acid is converted into an unsaturated fatty acid. So let us see an example of okay, so take an example of a fatty acid. So let us see, you have this OH. Okay. So this is a protein, something system. You have a double bond, okay, and then again between 7th and 6th there is one double bond, and then you have this five. So you have this 18H2, 18 carbon atom, and there are two double bond. And then what you do? You add hydrogen. Now how many hydrogen molecule you will need? You have two double bond. You have two double bond. Therefore, you add two hydrogen. And then the reaction is performed by addition of nickel catalyst and hydrogenation is performed. So every carbon-carbon double bond, every carbon-carbon double bond needs a molecule of hydrogen, If I have one double bond, like in case of oleic acid, I need one hydrogen. If I have two double bond, I need two hydrogen molecules. If I have three, I will need more hydrogen. If I have four, and likewise. Okay, so double bond will turn into single bond. Okay, these double bond will turn into single bond. How? In the hydrogenation process, the double bond at the carbon atom 10 and 9 will go away. And the double bond at the position of 7 and 6 will go away. Okay, so what happens? The reaction is simple. You just have this 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so the double bond is gone and you have simply, there is no change in this double bond. Okay, don't get carried away or don't get, you know, this is oxygen ka double bond. This has nothing to do with the hydrogenation. Only carbon-carbon double bond will participate in the reaction and you get a straight chain. Okay, you get a straight chain of carbon. So we no longer have double bond. We no longer have a double bond. Double bond turned into a single bond. So 16, 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9. Okay. So if you see, there is no double bond here. No double bond. And this has turned into a single bond. Okay. Double bond has turned into a single bond. Shape or the bond that so there is also change in the shape. Okay. There is a kink, but now this molecule is more straight. There is no kink or there is no bump. Bend. If you see the polyunsaturated fatty acid, one double bond, thoda kink hai. Ab thoda do double bond rahega, to thoda jada bend aega. Three double bond jada. Four double bond completely molecule will bend. I have already explained in my previous lecture. Okay. So a saturated fat is formed which has 18 carbon atom and zero double bond, and this is 18 carbon atom, two double bond. The bend has gone. Okay, so number of carbon has not changed. So no change in ester bonds, no change in the carbon numbers, no change. Only the double bond is changed into single bond. Okay. Just by reacting with the hydrogen, we can convert a polyunsaturated fatty acid into a saturated fatty acid. And if you only take this saturated fatty acid, and add hydrogen and perform the hydrogenation in presence of nickel and 200 degrees Celsius on a high pressure, no reaction will take place. Please keep this in mind. This double bond has nothing to do with this carbon. Only carbon-carbon double bond will participate in the hydrogenation reaction. Now, take an example of, you know, another molecule. Like, for example, oil. In case of oil, you have a complex. I gave you an example of, you know, linoleic acid with a two double bond, which is converted into, suppose, you know, just now we saw linoleic acid, which had 18 carbon with a two double bond is converted into now 18 carbon atom with a zero double bond, which is a stearic acid, okay, which is a stearic acid. But then if you see the oil, for example, corn oil or a sesame oil or a sunflower oil, a system is more complex. What do you mean by complex? Means you will have linoleic acid or linolenic acid or combination of these together, linolenic bhi rahega, oleic bhi rahega, linoleic bhi rahega. So it will have, you know, a combination of these fatty acid together. Suppose you have an oil, okay. In that oil, you have the, you have a fatty acid, okay. C double bond O, okay. And then we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and then there are groups, suppose, okay. Then I have another molecule of having, suppose, I'm just giving you an example randomly, so that you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. Suppose I have 4 double bond, okay. This chain may continue, or again the double bond may get increased, so depends, okay. So suppose you have another here, the molecule or the oil which has these fatty acid having different, you know, double bond. So how many number of double bonds are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, there are 9 double bonds. Okay, there are 9 double bonds. So there are 9 carbon-carbon double bonds. So how much H2 you need? You need 9 H2. Okay, so 9. So you add 9 H2 molecule, you use nickel catalyst, and you perform complete hydrogenation. What do? You perform a complete hydrogenation. What is the reaction? In the reaction, just now we saw, ester bond does not change. Ester bond not going to change. Number of carbon atom not going to change. What is going to change? Only the double bonds are going to change. So what is going to happen? Okay. So what we are going to get? We are going to get a simple. See, everything will remain same. Everything will remain. Number of double bond does not. Only the number of like these double bond will get converted into single bonds. A polyunsaturated triacyl glycerol is going to get converted into. Okay, so I'm not trying to just, okay. So what is happening in the complete hydrogenation? All the double bond have converted into the single bond. So that means a polyunsaturated triacyl glycerol is converted into a saturated fat. A saturated fat. This molecule has a lower melting point, whereas the molecule, resultant molecule after the hydrogenation has a higher melting point, okay? It is very, very firm. It is very, very solid. It is like if you freeze it, you know, it will become like a stone, very, very hard. If you freeze the butter, what happens? It's like stone, very difficult to spread, you know, ultimately you have to keep it outside and then allow it to get like melted, and then like it has become into a very solid, like a margarine. What you have done, a polyunsaturated triacyl glycerol, when performed with the complete hydrogenation, has become a very, very firm, solid, hard, and it is very difficult. So now the industry has decided, oh, this is a very, very solid mass that I have got, and I'm not able to use it very effectively. So what should the industrialist do? What should we do? Any answer? If we do not want it to have a very, very high melting point and a very, very firm texture, if we modify the texture, what will you do? Yes, Atharva? If you are not going to speak, I'm not going to tell you. I'm not here only. It is not my responsibility to teach. It is ultimately your responsibility also. And if you are just logging in and going away, I'm not going to continue the lecture. Are you there? Can you tell? Somebody can tell. Yes, if we perform the complete hydrogenation of a polyunsaturated triacyl glycerol molecule, a very firm, solid, very high, very, very high melting point substance is obtained, like a margarine or a hard butter. So if you want to modify, if you do not want to have a very, very solid fat, what will you do? How will you do that? Hello, I'm not able to hear anyone. Why?
Ma'am.
If you are not going to speak, I am not also going to speak. So until and unless you speak and show that yes, you are here.
Hello.
Hello, ma'am, am I audible? Hello?
Yes?
Ma'am, I'm not sure if my answer is right or no, but as to decrease the freezing point of ice, we use salt. So, can salt work in this case also? I'm not sure, but...
Yes, Drushti, are you there?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am,
why I am not able to hear you?
Hello, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Ma'am, message.
Yes, Kunjan, Komal. Can you unmute and talk? or you are not able to mute, unmute.
Ma'am?
Ma'am, can you hear us?
Anyway, it shows that you are least concerned, you are least bothered. I will also not bother. Forget about it. I will just go ahead. So in case of complete hydrogenation, basically what happens, if you see that there are 9 hydrogen bond, you want to perform the complete hydrogenation, and you perform the complete hydrogenation and you find that the resultant product is very, very hard. I showed you in the previous example that all of these bonds were converted into a single bond and these molecules were straightened. But then it was very, very solid and it had a very, very high melting point. So what we need to modify is, instead of using 9 hydrogen, you just use 3 hydrogen molecule, so that you don't want all the molecules to get converted, and you just convert, you know, these only double bonds into single bond. So resultantly, when you perform only, and this process is called as a partial hydrogenation. So you don't go for, you know, the complete hydrogenation. So, but then when you perform the partial hydrogenation, you see some bonds are not converted into a single bond, and double bond are still there, and here in the third molecule, which is here, or the third chain, these bonds, unsaturated bonds, have been converted into saturated. So you have still unsaturation. That means you are able to, you know, lower the melting point. So because of this chain, there will be like saturated fatty acid and unsaturated fatty acid, and this helps in resultantly you will get a semi-solid mass or semi-solid fat. Okay, semi-solid fat. But then when you perform a partial hydrogenation, when you perform the partial hydrogenation, what happens? You get only, you know, a certain amount of saturation, and there is still unsaturated. But during this partial hydrogenation process, there is a disadvantage, and disadvantage is some of the fat, the bonds that you see have converted into trans. See, this is a trans. Trans means like you have, this is cis, okay, H is on the same side. But trans means you get one H here and one H here, okay, instead of here H. So there are trans. Here is one trans, here is one trans. So during during partial hydrogenation, the trans fatty acids are formed, and it is very well known and very well established that the trans fatty acids are really, really bad for health, and they increases the level of bad cholesterol and decreases the level of good cholesterol. So therefore, partial hydrogenation is not recommended. Instead, a complete hydrogenation is recommended. This is the melting point, which I already showed. London dispersion forces, like suppose if you take a helium, this I have already explained, like how a helium molecule would have 2 protons and 2 electrons, and these London, because of the London, there will be an attraction between molecules, intramolecular and intermolecular, and then there will be attraction. And interestingly, these, you know, electrons gets attracted to the proton of another molecule, and this is called as a intermolecular forces. Okay, intermolecular forces. And also there is a repulsion, and because of these intermolecular forces, one molecule looks so different than the other. For example, the fatty acid like N-pentane. same number of carbon atoms are same, but the only difference is they are arranged in a different way due to this London dispersion forces. One is spherical, like surface area, as I mentioned, and one is straight, very nicely blocked. So hydrogenation process also, but then trans fatty acids are formed. Trans fatty acids that are formed, which are straightened. The molecules are straight in the trans fatty acids also. Like.
Hello, ma'am.
So in the hydrogenation process, we just now saw the example that, this chain was like completely, straightened, like you got the saturated fatty acid. But then at the same time, you saw that the trans bonds are created or trans fatty acids are formed. And these trans fatty acid increases the melting point. They are solid, but at the same time, they are more dangerous than the saturated fatty acid, which are natural, which are cis, okay? So they have a very greater impact on causing the cardiovascular diseases. So if you look at, this 16-1, like palmitoic acid, one double bond. So if you get, if you add one hydrogen molecule, this bond will get converted and you will get, a straight molecule of, fat. Okay, this is the same. So suppose you have an oleic acid, 18 carbon atom with the one double bond, you will get a fatty acid, that is ellagic acid, which is, saturated fatty acid. But then at the same time, you see, you have H here and H here, and this is a trans. So trans fatty acids are formed during the partial hydrogenation process. Linoleic, this is the linolenic acid, three double bond, and then you convert this, like if you have a linoleic acid, like two double bond, then you add one hydrogen molecule, one double bond gets converted into oleic acid, like one double bond still remains, like you get the semi-plastic or semi-solid fat. Still you further add one more hydrogen molecule, the oleic acid gets converted into stearic acid, which is fully, fully saturated. Okay, so saturated fatty acids, they fit very closely together in a very, very regular pattern because there is no bending, and therefore they have a solid fat, whereas unsaturated, they cannot, packed very closely, and because they have a very weak London dispersion forces between each fatty molecule. Like a very good example, like if you take the twigs and branches of the tree, and then you put them, see, this is not very much, but only because of the bending, you could not accommodate much. But then you see this wood, which has a very straight wood stacked on each other, you can accommodate more. And similarly, unsaturated fatty acids, that is why liquid. So hydrogenation is nothing but the hardening of the fat. And I have already mentioned the degree of hardening could be controlled by the addition of the hydrogen. The same example I gave. Like if you have more double bond, more H2 is needed, and then you convert a unsaturated fat into a saturated fat. And if there is no double bond, a saturated fat with the addition of hydrogen, no reaction will take place. Okay, but then in the partial hydrogenation, what happens? A cis bonds are formed, and which is not recommended. This molecule just now I draw. So cis and trans. So oil is basically mixed with the catalyst. And nickel is just a preferred one. And the temperature varies depending upon the type of oil, which oil, whether it is refined, whether it is non-refined, and then it is exposed. And while stirring, the hydrogen is added at a pressure of up to 60 psig. The agitation is very, very necessary so that this hydrogen should come into contact with this double bond. Okay, to add dissolving this hydrogen to achieve the uniform mixing of the catalyst with the oil and to help and dissipation of the heat of the reaction. The starting oil must be refined. What will happen if the oil is not refined? Suppose here is a phospholipid. The uniform hydrogenation will not take place. It should be bleached. If you have a pigment, you know, carotenoid pigment, or it should have more, it should not have any caustic soda remained or soap stock or food stock remained. So it should be in a very low in soap. It should be dry without any moisture. The hydrogen gas must be dry and free of carbon dioxide or sulfur or ammonia. The catalyst must exhibit long-term activity. Suppose, you know, you are using nickel. Only the reaction will get activated at the in the presence of nickel. So it should give a very good reactivity, very long-term reactivity. Okay, otherwise you will have to change again and again and replace again, and that it will not be a very cost-effective operation. Selectivity of hydrogenation and isomer formation can be easily removable by the filtration. And see, there are isomers are also formed during this hydrogenation reaction. And as I mentioned, a lot of trans fatty acids may also form during this. So it has to be, you know, under controlled condition. The course of hydrogenation reaction is usually monitored by determining the change in refractive index. So the moment you have more saturated fatty acid, you know, more saturated fatty acid, the melting point of the oil will change, and simultaneously because of that the refractive index will also change, and the refractive index is directly related to the degree of saturation. Okay, so when the desired endpoint is reached, the hydrogenation of the oil is stopped, and then the oil is cooled, and then it is processed. Okay, so interesterification is like the same thing in which you play with the fat. I will try to, you know, continue this in the more detail in the next lecture, but just to give you an idea, interesterified fat, since the interesterification is generally affects the compound known as esters in the oil used, which produces a fat which is a bit complicated, but it is a natural vegetable oil such as rapeseed, which is combined with the stearic acid, so that, you know, you have a different plasticity, you have a different fatty acid with a different melting point. Okay, so but it has a disadvantage because during this process, a lot of trans are produced, and this is not good because interesterified fat is believed to lower the level of good cholesterol, and it raises the bad cholesterol, and it also causes, you know, diabetes. It's not good for health, and it causes atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis means you have these arteries, and in these arteries, this fat goes and deposits, and then you know, the blood cannot flow very smoothly, and there is a pressure build up to flow up the blood towards the heart, and that is why, you know, a heart attack takes place. Okay, so we will continue this interesterification reaction in the next lecture, and